So the next segment, as I was saying, is going to be a discussion by four colleagues who have been doing some great work, starting with David Brain at New College of Florida, and then followed by Hans Karssenberg of Amsterdam, Setha Low of City University of New York, and finally Vikas Mehta of University of Cincinnati. And we'll start with David as soon as we get his presentation loaded. And then we'll have an opportunity for some discussion after that. And again, we're trying to synthesize our discussion from the breakouts and from the discussion we had this morning about implementing the new urban agenda and what are the key issues that we need to take forward.
I took the title and the theme seriously, the idea of research into practice. But I want to raise the question of whose knowledge and into whose practice. I'm a sociologist who also is involved in sort of practical applications. I work with designers and planners in community engagement kinds of projects. So this reflects my research as well as my experiences. And so what I'm trying to do is make an argument that if we look at how planning and the evolution of planning has affected the politics of planning, we see a process of the basically decomposing the civic. And I think it helps to account for some of the issues with public space. And I want to suggest in the end that there's four emerging moves among planners that have the potential to become the basis for reconstituting the civic. If you go back a little ways, here was what the future of the city looked like in 1893 at the World's Columbian Exposition in Chicago, the White City. And what I thought was interesting about this when you read about it is the commentators at the time noted not only was it beautiful, but the impressive thing was that it actually affected the behavior, the orderliness of the behavior of the people who attended the fair. And this was accomplished through the collaboration of professionals, of experts who knew what they were doing. This is what you could accomplish if the professionals worked together. 1947, a very different vision of what the future would be like, a very individualized utopia that was really, you know, sort of what people call the American dream. And this is the sort of landscapes that came out of that. So one of the questions I always ask is, well, so what is it that got us from that vision to this kind of landscape? And as a sociologist, my explanation is that if you look at the layering of institutions that are involved in the development regime, the organization of capital and financing, the bureaucratic administration of regulations, the organization of professional expertise, and the politics of the so-called public process, those things all work together to produce outcomes that nobody likes, but that nobody seems easily able to change. We get the suburban world, which is a world made up of the work of specialists, each solving their own kinds of problems, and each solution creates new kinds of problems. Right? So the landscapes we don't love are the landscapes produced by expertise and technical knowledge. So we have this institutionalized resistance to change that's really at the intersection between public bureaucracy, democratic politics, and market-oriented institutions with these paradoxes that it's, you know, the more we know, the more we create this specialization and division of labor that make it difficult to do anything differently. We create environmental regulation that actually encourages a narrower technical perspective rather than a broader and more holistic one, and public participation becomes part of the problem, not the solution. Even in discussions of sustainability, you'll notice that we have this great temptation towards technological solutions, designing engineering communities for zero carbon, zero waste. But if you look at this kind of example, which is from a group in Britain, you can ask this question, how would this building, how would this community learn and adapt over time, and whose hands are those? And that's the question I think is often missing. Whose hands are doing it? It reminded me of these design guidelines from the 1930s federal housing program in the States. The same mysterious male hands coming into the picture here. And, you know, it produced, you know, great housing solutions like this one, which you may recognize because it was made particularly famous by its eventual fate, the Pruitt-Igoe project in St. Louis. So research to inform whose practice. Research tends to be designed to feed technical expertise and authority. It's a technocratic sort of thing we do. I mean, that leads to the kind of reductionist approach that Jane Jacobs criticized as disorganized complexity, and it produces trained incapacity among professionals and institutionalized disconnection, which takes as a given the underlying conditions of inequality in both political and social. So if you think about then what planning has done to the political process, it basically looks like this. The situation that we face continuously is that there's this pervasive fear of growth in spite of a pervasive need to encourage it for economic reasons. We have bad democracy, an emphasis on the quantity of participation, not the quality, and a generalized collapse of faith in the whole democratic process. So public meetings tend to look like this, right? And these people, what's important about this image is these people don't even know what the meeting's about. They just showed up that way. So you get this weird politics where people show up to intervene in something and use the technical and procedural means to stop things. Technical discussions become politically charged, and political discussions, or what should be political discussions, become obscured by technical issues, and the whole result is a paralysis that reinforces all the business as usual problems that we have. So in the name of procedural fairness and democracy, we've created an unreliable process that actually undermines civic capacity and leads to nothing but reactionary politics. So in that context, what happens to public space? Well, the general program of action, the sociology of the built landscape, is sort of exemplified by a Walmart parking lot, a world of unencumbered individuals managed by a regulatory framework and a procedural state. Public space, that's the most common kind of public space. And then contrary to that, you have the ideal of urbanism, where you imagine a world of individuals who recognize the value of sustaining a common world, and where public space is defined by the private and the relationship between public and private, right? Identity to the public of the public space is given by its relation to the private and vice versa. And then this is supposed to develop over time, which makes it even more interesting and cool. So what happens to public space in the current regime? Well, the example I wanted to give, given the amount of time I have, I thought, well, I'll use this little anecdote from across the street. This is where the park across the street from my house, a pavilion that was built back in the 70s by the Hispanic American Alliance. They very proudly raised the money, built this pavilion, became a great community asset. But you might notice there's no furniture in it. The furniture was removed about a year ago because there were undesirable people gathering under that shelter, right? Unfortunately, removing the furniture didn't make it uncomfortable enough, so now there are all kinds of proposals, and the recent proposal is to actually buy the park from the city and privatize it, raise money in the community. So if you think about that, the first option is to manipulate behavior to exclude the undesirable. When that fails, the second option is to privatize. So here's a privatization impulse coming from the community, from the bottom up. So what's to be done? How do we address this? I've found, I'm trying to check my time here, so I'm now not doing too bad. Four things I've noticed among planners and designers that have interested me that I want to just sort of briefly touch on. The idea of an urban-rural transect, the charrette process, the idea of tactical urbanism, and the idea of lean urbanism. Not because these concepts in themselves are intrinsically significant, but they imply certain things that I think are really important from a sociological perspective. For the transect, the idea is that the human habitat is a diverse range of things, just like the natural habitats, that sort of follow a cross-section from the most natural to the most urban. And you can begin to think about places in terms of an ecology of places that people inhabit. And you can use this framework as an analytical framework to look at existing conditions. You can use it as a methodology for developing a code based on a form-based approach. But for me, what's important here is the recognition that what you want to try to sustain is a diversity in the built environment, recognizing that those differences are the basis of place identity and also real estate value. And you can also see that it's related to kind of social variation in the way we relate to each other and the built environment as you go from the most natural to the most urban, from different kinds of social norms of engagement, basically, with your surroundings as you move through different parts of the transect. And I could go into great detail, but For me, the implication of this is that you're now looking at places as part of a larger system of allocation of difference. And it makes possible a kind of precise, rational discussion of choices in the larger system. And I think it actually helps to reconstitute a civic sensibility and an ability to talk about social equity issues in terms of the distribution of access and assets. The second move is the charrette process as an inclusive design-centered collaboration. The charrette has basically been sort of revived as the idea of a multi-day collaborative planning event involving all the stakeholders and producing some kind of feasible project coming out of it. It's collaborative, it's cross-disciplinary, involves short feedback loops in an iterative process, and the outcome is an action-oriented result. And what I've noticed in observing these processes is one of the key things that makes them work when they work is that what you engage people in doing is actually building a common narrative about the planning intentions. So you actually, in this sort of co-production idea of the professionals working with the citizens, you get a common narrative that everybody gets to share as they come out of this process. So it's collaboration, not participation, and I think that's a key shift of framework that's important. The specialists are required to act as generalists. You have public engagement with substantive issues instead of technical issues, transparency in the decisions that are made, and a shared learning process that really kind of transforms the way people engage with the community. Third move, the idea of tactical urbanism. Now, this is not always a cool thing, and there's some issues there. For example, chair bombing can be very cool in some settings, but then you look at the unhoused individuals who put their lawn chairs on the sidewalk, and they're not allowed to do that. So there's some issues about who gets to reoccupy public space. But the key thing here is that what it does is it actively enables people to sort of rediscover that, hey, we can actually shape the space around us. And to the extent that these tactical interventions encourage that experience of efficacy in public space, I think that's really significant. And on top of that, the tactical can be linked to the strategic. This is an example from Memphis, where they took a sort of sad, neglected neighborhood center, and through a series of events and pop-ups and so forth, they were able to reactivate it in interesting ways. But to me, what's important is it wasn't just that they had a weekend event, but they catalyzed public and private reinvestment in the neighborhood. And then the fourth move is this idea of lean urbanism. And I like their tagline, making small possible. This is something that has come out of an idea that Andres Duany had, but he's engaged a whole lot of people in these discussions to try to think of ways to make changes quicker, more cheaply, in more practical ways related to sort of 21st century conditions. Some key ideas here, some small but strategic projects, incremental but cumulative efforts, things that are immediately responsive and adaptive. You engage people learning by doing, like in the tactical thing. You mobilize community-based resources in a way that accomplishes goals and at the same time builds community capacity. You combine essentially vision and action. Lately, I've been really fascinated by the Incremental Development Alliance that actually teach these small-scale development workshops with the idea that you could actually create homegrown developers who build something on their own block where they live, and they probably in many cases live in their project, right? They build a fourplex and they move into it. They're basically become developers who develop incrementally and bring about real neighborhood transformation that also is an economic transformation at the same time. And to me, that's a very fascinating sort of shift from the realm of planning and the experts, you know, telling you what to do, to engaging and sort of reconstructing a capacity in the grassroots. So in conclusion, I want to make an argument for replacing participation with collaboration and focus research on collaboration rather than how you get butts in seats at public meetings. And think about places, including public space, not just as containers and collections of affordances, but as things that we do together. right? Emphasis here on the making and not just the place. To me, it's the making of it that is really important, because the whole history of this system of land development and real estate is a system of disconnection of people from the making, right? They expect things to be done for them. I see it in public meetings all the time. People sort of, they always want to know, so what are you going to do? What are you going to do for us? And they're asking me that, an academic, you know, facilitating a public meeting. So what are you going to do? I say, I'm not going to do anything. I'm just facilitating the meeting. That's what I'm going to do. I also think design is an important part, not just because it needs to be beautiful and the designer has to make it beautiful for people, but that making it beautiful should be something that people... Oh, that's my timer going off. I thought I had the alarm turned off here. The design should be part of that, and that engaging people in a design process can actually be a really interesting way to work through conflicts that would otherwise maybe not be so tractable. And finally, I think we have this problem of trying to figure out how to transcend the limits of the development regime. Because what I've seen over the last decade watching professionals involved in placemaking is that there's a real danger in success. There's a real danger in getting drawn into the very development regime that you've been trying to change. You know, I hear it in just about every presentation when I go to some meetings. I haven't really heard it here today, but these presentations where people are talking, you know, about the great successes that they've had and the compromises that they've made to get there, but the great successes are often things that have happened precisely because they've compromised with the underlying structure that maybe needs to be questioned more radically and deeply. And I will stop. Thank you.
So thank you very much. One of the reasons I started Stipo as a team for urban development is because we felt 25 years ago that we need a more multidisciplinary approach. So I'm an urban planner myself, which in Amsterdam is considered a social science, by the way. But we also have a psychologist on board and somebody with more of an economic background, because precisely that is what the cities are made of. So let's see if this one works now. Yes, thank you. I would consider myself to be a practitioner, first of all. We help cities and communities set up processes of creating sustainable places in the Netherlands, outside the Netherlands. But then we also try to generate the practical knowledge that comes out of it and the methods that come out of it and learn in a kind of an open source network. So I'd like to talk about that towards the end of my presentation. To start with, I would like to do basically two of the things I love most in my daily work, and that is to take you out to the street and take you out to the communities. Because we are talking about human scale public spaces, and then we should be talking about, I guess, human scale architecture as a part of that. And this morning Fred was talking about opening up the design community. So that's, I guess, a large part of what we're trying to do. Maybe even embracing the design or hugging the design community. So how do we view the streets in that perspective? Well, this is a historic map of the historic city of Haarlem in the Netherlands. And for those of you who have been to Europe, there are many of these historic cities, obviously. And looking at a map like this, arriving to the city, coming out of the station, you would expect something really beautiful, organic, historic, right? And yet, this is how the city welcomes you. A building that never ceases to amaze me, because I guess this completely kills the public space forever. Of course, this was built in the 80s, when there was a kind of an anti-urban sentiment, at least in the Netherlands, but I guess internationally. There was the feeling of unsafety, and also there was a lack of money, so it was much cheaper to put the parking garage, obviously, on the ground floor level, and thereby completely kill the public space. I guess this is what happens when cities tend to focus on public space as the horizontal surface only, the space they own and think about the way the street is designed, and that's it. But I guess as a pedestrian, as a user of public space, you're not looking down to the floor all the time, are you? So I really like the outcome of one of the human skill groups said that I think that we should shift to more of the human experience rather than the human skills. So that's what I would like to talk about briefly. So, but to show a couple of more depressing examples, really. So this is what we did in the 90s. And this is what we did then. This is, by the way, the head office of OMA, the Office for Metropolitan Architecture. The worst ground floors are always by either government institutions or architecture institutions somehow. This is a government, a public building, in the recently built in the historic inner city of Amsterdam. If you would turn 180 degrees here, you would see the Rembrandt house. You would see lots of people. That's the house that Rembrandt stayed in, just to give you a sense of the history. And you see lots of people walking on the street. And then this is a facade on the south. And just imagine if it would have at least two doors and some interaction between the inside and the outside. So this is what we would think we would get to. We need to get to an understanding of public space, including also the facades of buildings, really, including everything you experience as a human being in public space. And then of that facade, the most important part is what we call the plinth. That's an English word that doesn't really exist in this way, but we're trying to introduce it, so please help us. Because, so this is the ground floor of the building, but it's not only the facade, it's also the everything that's behind it. It's a Dutch word, plinth, and if you Englishify it, can you say that? Then it's, I think it's plinth, right? So, but the concept is important. The concept is that it's about what's inside, how it relates to the outside, and including the shape of the facade. So a street can look like this, really. And this street, if you count the amount of doors here, this street has an average of a door every 4 meter. Every 4 meter, there's a new inside-outside relationship. There's a new function. During the day, at night, there's a huge mix. There's a mix of residential, of shops, of cafes. But it doesn't have to be about Western streets only. So, for us, this is not about beautiful or beauty. It's about the way the human interaction is working on the street level. So this is in Kenya or in Rio, one of the flat cities we were talking about, this morning. Sydney. So I guess there are many examples of where the streets, where we can get it right. So what we say is the street plinth may be only 10% of a building, but it determines 90% of the experience. Now, Fred Kent would say, architects shouldn't be allowed to design the first three floors of buildings altogether. I'm not that radical myself, so I think we need to work together and also understand the system deeper, because it's not only about the design, it's also about who's commissioning the design, it's about the mechanisms of users behind that, but that would all be too deep to go into now. And by the way, we're not only talking about ground floor use in a commercial sense, cafes and shops. It's also about creating good residential plinths. So and then this zone between the private realm and the public realm is really, really important, which we call the hybrid zone. That's where people will meet. So yes, you can count the doors on the street, and to your left you see 20 doors per 100 meters, so on average, every 4 meter new door. The middle section are the worst streets that we know in the Netherlands. They have one door every 200 meters, your typical office block streets, nothing happening there. And then more to your right, some of the great streets that Alan Jacobs has analyzed in his books. On average, at least a public function every 20 meters. So you can just go out to your street, count the doors, and know if you have a good street or not. And then if you, throughout our examples that we've gathered, you see that it's not only about the hardware and the design, but it's very much also about the use, and maybe even primarily about the use. And then it's also about the management and how the street is organized through time. So just a couple of pictures I took here, just two blocks away from here. It's called Butte Street, but this is not a butte, is it?
This is a building to the left side of the street, and I guess this is a residential building, but it does not connect with the street, right? So this is what we're trying to stay away from. And then if you turn to your right, then this is what you see on the right-hand side of the street. I would recommend you all go there. These buildings were built in around 1900, and as you may see, there's a kind of a veranda, there's a in and out relationship. And this woman over here to the right of the picture, she was actually taking care of the green stuff there in public space. It's not her private garden, but she's looking after it. Now, this psychologist on my team, he researched that if you have a good hybrid zone, that's where 80% of the spontaneous contacts in a neighborhood happen. So if you have this, then you miss out, then you miss out on 80% of spontaneous contacts in a neighborhood, right? Or this, a very common mistake made very frequently, and I guess this sums up the corporate city, doesn't it, this picture? I made this here yesterday on our walk towards the waterfront. This facade, there's so many things wrong with it. Where shall we start? So one misconception, I guess, is that transparent plinth is the same as using a large glass surface. Well, guys, it's not. Architects in the room, please don't do it anymore. Cities in the room, please stay away from this. Alter your building codes. Prevent this from happening. First of all, you see, the glass surface isn't transparent at all. Second, it creates a boring facade with no variation. And third, because what we experience as users in the street, half of that is the sound. We're not aware of that, but half of it is what you hear. And creating a facade like this is like when you're moving house and you take away the carpet and you take away the curtains and you see hear this awful echo in your room. And this is echoing all the sounds in the system and prevents you from having a good conversation on the street. So we need more sound dispersers, like in this case, for instance. So then the second, getting to the communities. How do we get to a more people-centered approach? Well, we've been looking at cases all over the world, and we see so many great initiatives. There's so much energy to change streets for the better. The Equal Streets initiative in Mumbai, this initiative in Durban, changing a flyover to a market. This one, a festival in Budapest, helping to open up empty and dead shops organized by the community. Or this one, the Lago da Batata, the potato square in São Paulo. And there's a bunch of people who started in the beginning of 2014 by gathering every Friday on the square. They started with 10 people, and by 6 months later, they had 10,000 people on the square. And now they're changing the square. So there's a lot of energy among civic initiatives, and yet this is a city that really wants to promote the quality of public space. The mayor, this is the mayor who enabled the Clean Streets Act and banned all the public advertising, but they don't know how to talk to each other. So I guess that's the point I'm trying to make here, and this is an example from our own practice where this guy came along and he wanted to have a restaurant and he said, I also collect trains, by the way. Can I put it in your space? And we thought he meant trains, but he really meant trains. So now there's this East German former restoration wagon, but this guy also employed the unemployed kids from the neighborhood and created this great place there. So this you could never have imagined in any kind of master plan, right? In this area, we work with the largest property investor of Rotterdam at the same time. So the point I'm trying to make here, and I really like this idea of getting from participation to collaboration more, is that we would say you need a middle-up-down system, not bottom-up, not top-down, but combining these two worlds. And that is very rare, I think. And I was very happy with the presentation from George about Bristol, because I think that's what you've been doing, right? Combining these two worlds. Well, a bit about how to translate knowledge into action, because there's so much knowledge out there, and why don't we get better streets? Why do we still see so many bad examples? Using our own book as an example, we've had so many wonderful partners leading up to this, Future of Places, UN Habitat, PPS, and we developed the book, The City at Eye Level, as an open source system, so you can download it for free, with 90 contributors from all over the world, some of who are here in this conference. And it's more, it's not an academic book, it's more a practical book. So it gives best practices worldwide, it provides criteria, methods, and lessons for practice. And it's also, for us, a starting point to take action with all our partners across the world. It's been translated into Portuguese in Brazil, and now this is our latest adventure to have a new Mandarin version, because we feel that it's important to reach out to new parts of the world with this book. Now, it's only an example, because there's so much, we don't claim to have the truth, there's so much knowledge in this room right now. The only thing I would say, which really, really ask you to provide your knowledge open source, because I think that's the first step we need to make. So you can download this book for free, and I hope you will do the same with your knowledge. And then, of course, and by the way, if your city is not on the map as a case in the book yet, please feel free to come to us, because we'd like to see it as a dynamic system, right? So I guess we can have some more cases in Canada, maybe. And then to translate this knowledge into practice, it's not enough to only provide it, but we really need this learning by doing system. So having workshops out on the street, using the knowledge on an active base. This is, for instance, when we launched the book in Porto Alegre, we did a place game there with all the students going to the neighborhood square and working on that. So we need to not only provide the knowledge, but also provide systems of learning by doing. And how great would it be after Habitat 3 if we could do this on a worldwide scale, right? So we need to get from a two-dimensional to a three-dimensional approach, I would say, for the discussion. From a sole government responsibility to a shared responsibility system of property owners, users, developers, designers, and the government. Now design your building code like that. From design to use, design, and management, so get the hardware, software, and orgware in. From top down only to middle up down, partnerships. And from this knowledge gap we experience in practice to open source knowledge platforms, toolkits, and training. Thank you very much.
Hi, I thought that was great. Good afternoon. I hope you're all having really a wonderful afternoon. We want to talk about research, and a few people have been referring to things that can go wrong, and how in our thinking about how to make better places. And I really want to take a few moments to talk about, first, here's one of my ideal public spaces and what I mean by public space for everyone. To think about the relationship of public space and civic life. You know, for me, public space provides the potential for civic life, because this is where we can meet one another, both for cooperation and for conflict, both for discussion and sometimes for dissent. And for me, civic life in a just city is really thinking about diversity. I mean, this is personal, this is how I really think about it. And a recognition of all people's right to the city. And I've spent the last 25 years doing research on public spaces of all kinds, mostly in Latin America and the United States, and come to the conclusion, along with my students in the public space research group, that there are certain social processes, power dynamics, design and planning decisions that influence whether public space and civic life really happens. And I've called them, for purposes of today, threats to public space and civic life. And of course, I can only touch on a very few pieces of what we've been able to discover, but I thought it would be worth a moment to go through and talk about some of them, because I think we often just fly by and don't really think as deeply as we could about what these threats might look like, and I hope we can also get to, if we have threats, then these are also opportunities. So I'm going to start with lack of representation. Here is the erasure of local history is top of my list. This is Independence National Historical Park in Philadelphia. It was part of a very large gentrification project in the center city of Philadelphia. We were asked to come in and work with the National Park Service because that entire park was not used by any local Philadelphians. particularly African Americans, Puerto Ricans, Vietnamese, all kinds of ethnic groups, I would say marginalized groups, never came to this park. So we went in and we talked to them and we tried to find out why. And the why was very simple. They told us that all their history had been erased to make a white colonial park as part of that process. And the only thing black African Americans told us was the ink on the Declaration of Independence, that there was no representation. So the erasure of local history is an easy way to ruin your public space. Loss of cultural symbols. This is Pelham Bay Park in the Bronx, originally an enclave served a mostly white, I would say ethnic population in the Bronx, and most of the Latinos who came to the Bronx felt excluded. So they started Salsa Night and started putting all kinds of Latino cultural symbols in there, and it has been a fantastic success at Orchard Beach. On the other hand, the previous residents now feel excluded. Is there a way to include everyone's symbols? Restoration without social functions. This is a boathouse of Olmsted and Vaux, and that when it was restored did not get its social functions. They were thinking about social functions that would draw people to these places. When we do historic preservation, we need to think about the social function, not just the beautification of the building. And finally, adequate territories for desired activities. This is Jacob Riis Park. In the Rockaways, this is the bay, a beach bay that is very famous, very old gay beach in which no services were provided, no lifeguards, bathrooms, whatever, and it was inadequate for their needs and began to deteriorate until some attention was brought to it. These are all cases, however, that our research were able to put people in contact and make changes. Threats to public space, privatization. I can do this very quickly. Commercialization, extreme controlled access, overregulation. I love this, landscape architects. This was designed as a sitting wall and supposed to be a place to sit. And overregulation in particular keeps your teenagers out. Teenagers do not lock. As you all know, don't like long lists of regulations. This is an easy way to keep people out of your public space. And something we've been referring to that I call a financialized moral landscape, a sort of reevaluation through privatization of how people view each other. And it becomes that they get viewed in terms of their financial worth. Threats to public space and civic life, securitization. Haven't talked too much about it in the conference. I think it underlies a lot of what we could talk about. Zero tolerance policing. This is both Costa Rica here, you see, and New York City. Surveillance. For surveillance, these are brand new towers in San Jose, Costa Rica. You can see them all over Latin America, and these are ubiquitous video cameras that you find in Union Square, 243 cameras trained on that square. Barriers as well as bollards create a really formidable landscape. And in the United States, and I keep this to the U.S., but it's not only in the U.S., we have a racial and cultural profiling. I want to point out that this is Costa Rica, and these are Nicaraguans that the police are bothering who are in Parque Central, and they are being profiled as somehow other. And then we have a case of students at NYU protesting the racial profiling in the U.S. And finally, social injustice. Unfair distribution of space. I think that's pretty obvious. Great two slides. On the top is the park, park in the Bronx, and on the bottom is the Central Park Conservancy's great lawn of Central Park. Really different places, very unfair distribution throughout the city. A lack of procedural justice. I want to slow down and say a little bit about this. This is the Mission Playground soccer field. I don't know how many of you followed this. In San Francisco, great example. The kids in the Mission had been using this soccer field forever. I mean, their fathers had used it and mothers had used it. And one day they go down to set up their soccer game. And they're a group of white sort of techie guys, young guys, come along and say, oh, no, we paid a fee, and this is our soccer field now, and you can't play here. We've got it for, what, 2 hours? I don't know. And the kids look at them, and, the, you know, suddenly out of the blue that this space had been privatized through limited access without any what I call procedural justice. In the bottom slide down there, that's the meeting with the mayor in which they won in their suit to try to get back their local park. So here's a success story. But on the other side, I have a slide from Peru where it's a lot less successful, where public space is, these are the charges you have to pay in order to do different activities in a public space. And these are decisions that do not include the citizens and who have to live by them. A lack of recognition of difference. This has been mentioned a couple of times today. This is Tel Aviv, South Tel Aviv. It's a park where asylum seekers live because there is no way to process them. It has a direct impact on public space in Israel, in all the countries that I've been spending a lot of time in, trying to look at ways to make these spaces diverse and positive spaces. And a lack of interactional justice by authorities. This is a slide of a recent incident in the Bronx. These two kids are sparring. They're not fighting. Something they do, it's part of their everyday social behavior. They were stopped and booked by the police who did not know or understand that this is, you know, this is part of what, this, David, did you read about this, this activity? And the kids were really, really angry that the police had no idea of who they were, what they were doing, and thinking about just a good example of what I call interactional injustice by the authorities. Okay, so where does that leave us? Oh, I'm good. I've moved along really fast. It leaves us with just some of the things we found that don't work, but we can turn those into opportunities. And I think that that is my final message. When we think about threats to public space and civic life, we can also think about opportunities. And we can reverse the kinds of projects that we've talked about and make sure that we begin to implement things that we can find evidence, we can find in our research, find in our evidence-based design packet. There should be evidence of local history. I think most of you know that. I'm speaking to the converted, but I think it's important to have it down. We want to retain cultural symbols. We want to retain them, and we want to retain them for everyone. I mean, this is a really symbols are really powerful. Substituting one group of symbols for another is a great idea to bring people in, but you don't want to erase those symbols that were there before. Like in the Orchard Beach. I think Orchard Beach is such a great example. Restoration with social functions. I don't know if that's an issue for so many of you, but it's certainly in the cities of the Northeast and in Latin America, it is a big issue that when we restore places, when we think about historic preservation, let's think about the sociality that enlivened, illuminated, made vital those places. Adequate territories for desired activities. That's part of placemaking. It's tricky. I get asked about it a lot. That's a bigger conversation. The very best public spaces are spaces, I think, where groups of people and with different needs and different abilities can find their own space, can create a kind of a place attachment and place identity, and yet still have a way to circulate together. I imagine a beach with a boardwalk or a park with a walkway. You can't force people to come together, but you can bring them together in creative ways. Privatization, let's think about open access. Not all private, we're gonna live with privatization. So saying that it's, you know, 100% bad is no longer an issue. But I think we can think about privatization and think about its impacts and imagine that many of the things that happen really limit who can use it and who is going to be attracted to space. So let's think about open access, free events and activities, limited regulation. Think about cooperation and collaboration. I also like that term, collaboration rather than participation, Hans. I think, you know, that really, I mean, David, excuse me, that really works when you're both using that term. Rather than the kinds of lack of procedural, lack of working together. Securitization, we know community policing works. We know that zero tolerance policing is, and racial profiling don't. people watching rather than surveillance camera, flexible and porous boundaries. We have a new Parks Without Boundaries in New York City. Respect and understanding rather than racial profiling. And finally, we need the basics. Fair distribution of space, good systems of procedural justice. I think it's not everything, but I think without it, we're still facing problems. Social recognition of all groups, that's a tough one. It's a societal level one, and many of you have heard me say here that I think public space reflects our societies, and I think we have to really think also of the top and the bottom at the same time. If we see it in public space, you know what's going on at the macro level, and how do we bring that together? How do we do something about that? How do we get social and political recognition of all? And finally, interactional justice for all, and that's something we can all participate in. It looks like I left care out, which I often like to talk about, sort of an ethic of caring, and it seems to have dropped off my thing, but it has come up most recently. And with that, I can thank you for your time and attention.
Thank you, Michael. So I'm going to talk about something that we've, I guess, mentioned here as a pretty important piece of the public space that we talk about. But this is almost a 10-year-old research that I've been continuously conducting. And it's kind of personal for me in the way that the street meant in India, where I grew up, that we never really thought of it as something that was part of a public space. It was part of daily life, and life never existed without it. You know, you played on it, you went to it, you did all kinds of things on the street, and there were really, really very few barriers on the street. Of course, in my last almost 20 years in being in the US, I kind of got interested in streets, and I'm going to give you a little optimistic view and obviously some pessimistic trends that we've talked about here quite a bit. So why talk about the street? And I think of it as these three things. It's ubiquitous, it's pan-cultural, which is kind of really important because it exists almost everywhere. We can talk about several cultural differences, different scenarios, different locations, but the street is a core piece of public space that exists, and our settlements are made of that. And so it's a quintessential public space that we have everywhere. Bruce Katz this morning talked about cities, and I guess he used the word proximity, which is key to what cities give us. And that proximity really provides us with access and encounter of all kinds. So in my view, the street as a public space is one of this really ubiquitous space that provides us with proximity, access, and encounter. This is a map of a portion of Cincinnati. It could be any city, it doesn't matter. Typically, you see the white, which is streets, not highways, just streets. And if you collapse this diagram into white is in one and black is in the other, 42% of what you see in this glass unfilled is in streets, not highways. And this is not uncommon, even in American cities, where anywhere from 25% to 55% of space is in streets. So it's a particularly important and in many ways a low-hanging fruit where the street can be many, many, many things. And I've just listed some of the things where I look at the street as a place of survival, consumption, a place of socialization, protest, all of the things that we think of our public space should provide us with. And it becomes a real place for image, identity, and legibility, and hence a critical public realm. I will focus on neighborhood commercial streets or main streets, which are kind of, if made well, are the heart of a community. And the advantage that they bring to a neighborhood is this is the place where the private or the parochial rather meets the public. This is the first place where the child in the neighborhood can in fact get introduced to a publicness from where the sphere is further expanding. So I'm going to run through a series of photographs and talk about what can happen on a street. What's important to note is that these pictures are of really only three streets. There's so much that goes on streets. You can document almost everything. But these are three streets in the US, in the Boston area. And they're very, very ordinary streets. But it's a place for gathering, for very meaningful interactions. I guess the other note to make is these are photographs taken over only a few months, that all of this happens on the street, place to learn social skills of all kinds, especially for children, place to learn how to negotiate the environment, to learn and teach about curiosity and intrigue. And this is all happening on an ordinary street, a place for discussion and dialogue of all kinds, learning to be cooperative, working with others you don't know, and being creative in this case, learning about participation and civic behavior. And one of the very important things, this is the role of the public space, is the exposure to people unlike myself, you know, for that child, learning empathy and discovery and intrigue and play. Here, a little bench is everything but a bench. It is something for this child that can do a lot without even sitting on it. And it's a place for information. It's a place also for survival, that if possible, if our rules are just elastic enough, and if the management structures allow for what Setha was talking about, a controlled way of limiting and restricting, it's actually a place for survival. So how do we measure if the sociability of this public space? This was one of the projects that I worked on several years ago. And what you see here is kind of inspired by the work done by Appleyard in mapping the places where people are. Jan Gehl has, of course, done a lot of this, and William White. So what I did here is map where people were in social, in any kind of social interaction, and that they were stationary people. So these are not people moving around. They're actually in the place for at least a certain given amount of time. And what it shows us is it's not obviously equal. There are parts of the street that are much, much more populated than others, even though the street itself is a very vibrant feeling that you might have on the street. And the purpose of the research was to really tease out, both with quantitative methodologies and sort of quasi rigorous statistics, which you could apply to this, and qualitative studies with interviews being conducted and obviously very, very deep field notes and ethnographic studies of these streets. So several streets were studied to figure out what is going on here, why are people in certain locations, and why are they not in other locations. So some things are kind of obvious. We know people will sit where there are places to sit, as we know from many, many years. But that's not all. Hans talked about design, and I call it the physical environment. Use, what kind of land uses are there, and what kind of management structures, both that are allowed from the top down, and also what are created by those individual businesses that are actually kind of been given this public space of the street to occupy and allow others to personalize. And of course, there's, you know, this involved detailed interviews with people. I won't get into all of that in detail, but this is what it comes down to, that there are land use qualities, there are which talk about business variety, independent stores, personalization of the realm between the private and the public, and the permeability. Again, it's not transparency. It's not whether 25% or 40% of the surface is transparent or not. It's actually how permeable is it? Can you smell it? Can you hear it? So the permeability was designed as a variable in this way and sort of examined in that way. Then, of course, public seating, sidewalk width, you know, some very, very common things. What came to be really important is what people really assumed as community places became a really independent thing in itself that allowed for that socialization. But at the same time, we realized that you might find vibrant streets, but all sociability is not equal, as you know we've talked about a little bit here, that there are places that are largely places of consumption, which seem very vibrant, and they may have a whole lot of these characteristics, but they're not places of any production. There's no real production of public space. It's only the consumption of public space. And it's really only complete if there is a place for political activity, economic activity, survival with play, and access, and all of those things. That's when it becomes a critical public realm. So looking at some of the main streets, what we started to map was what are the kinds of activities and what are the differences in groups that are actually using these places. So where do you find a woman with a toddler, a mother with a toddler, and also a panhandler, where these differences are somehow mitigated and not cleaned out, that we want this place just for women and safety is an issue, so we should not have any panhandling here, or we should not have any protest here, or we should not have any teenagers here, so on and so forth. So the idea is to actually map this in fair amount of detail with what is going on in terms of which groups are using these and where. And one of the critical things that we have in public space, and this is just some examples of what we are doing now in Cincinnati, where I live now, of trying to map these activities and groups that use this. The one thing we have to understand is public space is actually not alone. There is a factor of time that is very, very critical. That public space can be expanded if we think about how it is used at different times by different groups, which happens somehow very, very naturally. There are people who will not get along with others, so there is conflict. But conflict can be resolved in space by the space itself where people gather, but it also gets resolved in terms of time. And so we need to be very careful when we think about conflict not being something that is not possible for different groups to resolve themselves. And think about the elasticity of space that time provides it. The street itself is actually quite elastic because it's a very long linear space and you have multiple locations where you can occupy it, but the notion of what is occupied when allows us to think about it a little more freely and a little more much more possible as a public space. So I'm not going to try and run you through all of the findings, but here are the key seven things. The design manage the street as a gathering space. That's critical. Make the street attractive to all users, and that happens in many, many ways. Preserve and support community gathering spaces. They're not going to be all neat and clean, crisp, places that everybody's going to love. They're going to be very different for different people. People who've lived there for a long time may find a grungy cafe or a convenience store that may not be attractive to hippies of today. So, and certainly make the street a delightful place. Let users and businesses claim ownership. Let the businesses claim ownership, but with the caveat that they cannot privatize the space, and it has to retain its publicness. And the city must assist businesses to manage the street so the role of institutions becomes really important. And each of these has, you know, detailed sort of findings that I'm not going to bore you with, but I'll go to just the last aspect. So what might be meta strategies that are not really only limited to streets, but really public space? And very, very quickly, just if you think about studies from ecology. In ecological thinking, they talk about health of systems through coexistence, not competition. So the view that it's the survival of the fittest is only true that much. In ecology, things actually coexist. And they coexist sort of with different levels of interconnectivity. So multiple systems are interconnected, and everything is not stable. So we need to, again, think about it. It cannot be a system that is stable. There are things that are stable and unstable. So conflict and dissent is part of the system. And conflict is managed through distribution and diffusion, not by removal. Again, this is very, very applicable to public space. And so for the street, which is a place of interchange, if it's designed and managed well, or access for travel, commerce, leisure, sociability, and survival, we need to think about it both as a path, but also as a place. It should be a coexistence of different people, activities, and forms, even though all of them are not necessarily understood in a family. The controls have to be localized and through negotiation. Again, not through top-down regulation, but negotiation. And there should be myriad governance systems, which are social. There may be things about transportation, as we see in complete streets, economic governance systems, and cultural systems that we kind of forget. And I think this is, on the last couple slides, we think of our time in the past many centuries as simplicity, which we started to understand as disorganized complexity, and we started to be very simplistic, homogenous, and monocultural. That's what we were doing in the previous century. But moving forward, we need to celebrate this complexity and think about how can we organize this in a very, very multicultural and connected world. And we need to celebrate heterogeneity and complexity as we move forward. Thank you.
Great. So we've had a very busy day, a lot of ideas, a lot of pretty mind-numbing detail in terms of what the challenges are that we face. And I think what might make sense to start out is to have Peter and Fred express their thoughts and ask questions, if you'd like to, of the other four speakers who just spoke. What do you see in terms of what you started out in the day and the goals that you saw for the day? What do you see emerging as sort of the key lessons and the key questions that you'd like to ask the other speakers?
That's so hard.
Just the one thing, just one thing.
You know, I have to say, because our whole focus is how do you create a great street? How do you get people to become part of that, literally storefront by storefront by storefront? So if we can find that kind of personality of a storefront, we can get it out on the street, people on the street, we will have created something for people to look at. People look at other people. So we're in a kind of proactive mode, taking your sort of framework, but when we go to the street, it's all about bringing life to it. And then the problem with, if you go, say, to Copenhagen, which does a very good job of bicycling, but they do a terrible job for pedestrians because they used the lanes for, they don't allow wider sidewalks, they don't allow cafes out there. You might go along a street and there might be four tables with eight chairs, and you have to walk around it because the sidewalk is only so wide. So what we've done is we've taken away kind of the spontaneity by over too much control over some of these streets, and we've lost that placeness that really we thrive in good streets. Now, there's a great street, we were in Gdansk, not too long ago, a month ago, and there was this, it was about, say, the street, building to building was 90 feet, but there was a sort of a porch, and the porch came out about 20 feet on each side, and then the steps came down, and you could either go down in or up above. I've never seen a better designed street ever in the world, because it just had all these layers, and you kind of felt that you could look down, you could look up, There was a might be a cafe, and the next one would be someone sitting there trying to sell something. It was one of the most alive streets, more like the kind of souks and bazaars that you find in other places. So I guess what I'm saying is that there's so much potential for each street if you bring it alive in various ways. And it has to do with the plinth.
But yeah, what Hans was saying, right.
It really makes it work.
Thank you for using that word, Francis.
Plinth, remember that. So, thought.
Great word. Well, Hans, you talked about the plinth, and you talked at one point about the fact that it's very important to be able to see into the street, you know, into the building, to have that, as Kevin Lynch talked about, that that depth at the street. How do you react to what Fred said about the different layers, the different elements at, you know, at scale?
So I wish there was only one recipe for a great street, which of course there's not, because every context is different. If you look in Stockholm, for instance, you have to take the snow in the winter into consideration, and in different climates you have to do different things. Where the sun is really hot during the day, you have to provide for shade and et cetera, et cetera. But I think, of course, Fred is right in the sense that it's all, we can talk about human skill and then it sounds like a kind of this general word, but if you then go out to the street and observe and see, for instance, look at newly built projects, and you can see that the city had it in its vision. The architects were even trying to achieve a human skill, but yet they failed grotesquely. So the trying to get to human scale is so much about the details of a plinth and of the different units, and I guess that's what you're trying to say, that it's richness in details, it's the inside and the outside. And then there are some lessons that you can take. For instance, if you want people to open up more to the street, then you should have this hybrid zone of 1 meter from the facade to the street. Because if it's a harsh separation between private and public, people will just close down their curtains.
You need that filter between the public and the private.
Definitely.
But don't let architects design the bottom three floors. And that came from that guy right there, who is developing a project in Brasilia. And their development pro forma or outline is to make sure that it isn't one-dimensional and that it is open and it's flexible and it can change. So that's another part of the plinth, which I'm sure you would agree with, is that it can change morning, noon, and night even, or in seasons.
Other comments from the panelists on that?
Yeah, I was asked to comment today.
Yes, please.
I'm pessimistic.
You and Patrick.
I believe all desirable places we have today will be destroyed by over-densification sooner or later. And so we have to learn to build more good public space, obviously. Unfortunately, the disciplines that are involved are wrongly educated. It will take many years from now to change the system. That's why we started to talk about this shifting perspective from objects to places, in order to shortcut the discussion among the politicians or something. But in order to create new great places, I think the most important aspect is one that David Brain brought up, and that is the fine-grained plot structure.
Right.
That so local money can build in a city, not only global capital or pension funds, etc. Nothing can be more important than to use the fine-grained plot structure. Mm-hmm.
We were in the economic spillover breakout, and there was discussion there about the idea of a really close to what Patrick was talking about, the city that's concentrated and it's all about the center, as opposed to a more polycentric city and a polycentric scale, lots of different scales working together. And you have written about that before. You have thoughts about how, and you talked about that a little bit this morning, how it's not about just going into the core of the city, it's about having more of a continuous economic interaction. You want to comment on that a little more?
Yeah, what we need is, with the exception of the fine-grained plot structure, we need to build more main streets again. Mm-hmm. We don't do that anymore. We haven't built a new main street in Sweden since the 30s or something. And main streets historically have the most diverse offering. And main streets are not shopping streets. They're a place where you have everything, light industry, independent chains, everything is mixed on them. And many famous chains have started as individual stores at the main streets. But how do we build them again? That is a very interesting question.
Right. I guess in a lot of the reviving US cities with this notion of walking and healthy places, biking, there is kind of a revival of the main street, especially in the cities that are built on the streetcar network. And the land use is probably hollowed out, doesn't exist in those main streets anymore, but the framework and the bones still exist. So there is that revival actually happening. I can speak of Cincinnati, which has 52 neighborhoods, and we are mapping each main street with every use and how it's actually changing over time. And out of the 52, we are finding 32 of those main streets are really, really back to putting down a grocery store that's a local grocery store, to bringing in other businesses, not just fancy restaurants and, you know, cafes.
Yeah, that's the piece that I'm still puzzling about, and both to, I guess, to everyone, that I love this conversation about the street. It's great, it's wonderful, and when we get to the detail of what Hans and Vikas and Fred are talking about, I certainly support that, but I have images in my head constantly coming up of, say, Paris and the banlieue. I keep thinking of the cities like New York City and all these cities with tremendous discrepancies, incredible discrepancies of wealth, but also of infrastructure, of parks, of equity, of policing, of lights, of anything. And I wish there was a way, and I don't yet know the right way, but I keep trying to work towards a way to keep that image in our minds as well, because that is about the street, but those streets are the most devoid of any investment, the most devoid, but they're devoid for other reasons, for larger structural reasons that we don't have control over, say. So I just want to constantly create this, remember the suburbs, remember the relationship between the developed and prosperous parts of the city with those that are not, and how do we begin to integrate those areas as well in a positive, equitable, inclusive way at this next scale up, so that the new city, I mean, Peter is negative, but if we build new city, how do we reintegrate all parts of the city together?
David, you had a very interesting observation about the perfect dysfunction, the perfect storm of political and technical dysfunction, it seems like. And not to be, again, pessimistic, but there are some opportunities there to find ways to move forward at a smaller scale. That's a theme you had, isn't it?
Yeah, although I kind of wanted to pose a question for the panel. I mean, all day long I've been hearing, and you know, it's heartening to hear the constant call for diversity and inclusion, but my experience with issues of diversity and inclusion has to do with issues of real conflict over who gets to use public space, who gets to use the street,
exactly.
And for what. I mean, the city where I live has a reputation of being the meanest city in the United States because of historically the way the city government has responded and the police department has responded to a population of houseless people. And living in South Florida, we get a great flood of people moving south in the wintertime, about the same time that some of those people are tourists, snowbirds. I always say we can tell when the seasons are changing because the colors of the license plates change. We get a lot of people from Canada, from the other side of Canada mostly, a lot of people from the Midwestern United States. And we also get a lot of people who are houseless, and they come down because they need the warmer weather, not because they want to play golf, but because they don't want to freeze to death. So we have these constant battles over who can use the street, who can use the parks, who can use the public spaces, and for what. And the police have been really nasty and have been sued several times. There are these issues of rights. All the Main Street businesses are up in arms. There's a movement of local condominium owners who are extremely hostile to the unhoused. And it's just not clear to me how, even if you design really wonderful active streets, I mean, a lot of people doing yoga in the street is just not going to resolve those conflicts.
Right, right, right.
Right?
Well,
we're on the same page.
Sarasota.
Isn't part of the response to that, I won't say answer, but the response, to look at the character of the public space, and if it is in fact one amorphous public space, then you're going to have conflicts over people trying to use it, as opposed to a more, if you will, polycentric public space that has lots of different places that people can be in and be comfortable next to each other within. I wish Paul Moraine were here, because he talks about the idea that, you know, public space manifests a political arrangement that is the resolution of conflicts, you know. And we've lost sight of that, haven't we? I mean, everyone thinks of public space as just this thing that doesn't have the... Do you want to speak to that, Setha?
Well, I was just saying, public space is produced. It's something we don't... I think Vikas actually brought it up, and I know Hans and I have talked about it, but, I mean, we produce publicness. It isn't a property in and of anything. I mean, you could get into arguments, but we produce publicness, and lots of us and the group we worked with this afternoon were arguing that part of that publicness, part of public space, is the agonistic as well as the cooperative. That's the trick. Everybody says, you know, how do I know what's a good public space, and is it overregulated or over-policed? And I said, well, could you have a protest there? Could someone stand up and speak out against something? Would that be possible? And if it's impossible, then is that really the kind of public space that we want? And that's, Paul says the reverse, kind of, that he's saying it's the outcome. I would say public space is that process of coming together, of having all kinds of conflicts, of resolving, not resolving, moving on, that process is part of making a public, a lively public. If that includes some of the things, Fred, that you're thinking of, you know, sometimes conflict can create very lively public space. It isn't always everybody hand in hand.
So we've been working on public spaces and since we met PPS on placemaking in so many different situations right in the city center of Amsterdam, but also on the outskirts of cities in much less privileged areas. And although the outcomes are always completely different, so no, in those areas we're not talking about yoga. Of course not. But the young kids over there, for instance, they are frustrated because they have no place to go. And there is one shopping mall which is the center public space in the area, and they're being kicked out of that. So in this example, for instance, we managed to create a process with the owners of the shopping center where the kids were allowed to develop a place for themselves to do basketball clinics on top of a parking garage. So the outcomes are different, of course. And in these neighborhoods, there is an informal economy as well, and an economy as well. And I guess if you look at informal settlements, then the streets are bound to be much more lively and have much more plinth areas, but just spontaneously, nobody ever planned that. That's just the way the economy of those areas works. So I guess you can release that in more planned areas with a lower income population where you don't have all these facilities most of the time, because a lot of the times they were built in the 60s and the 70s and the 80s when we were only separating functions. And these areas don't allow for these sorts of functions to be there.
And going back to something that Fred said, the idea that in certain public spaces you can see different layers and different levels, we have lost that understanding of how public space can be articulated and the private space can be articulated. I think also, as we're talking about this, I think of Ali Madanapour's work. Someone else that we've worked with who talks a lot about how different spaces actually have boundaries and tacit rules about who can be there and who can use them and under what conditions. And that is what it manifests as a visual delight, you know, lots of layers, lots of things going on, which is what you were alluding to, Fred. And so I think these things are all interconnected the more you tease them out, as is often the case, right?
Yeah, I think there's a hearing that there's a lot of things you can do design-wise in the built environment, but it's connected to that is the other side. Somehow we have to sort of recultivate the sense of the value of the public. I mean, people generally sort of have the value of say, the freedom of speech, that people should be free to say things in the public realm and so forth. But the idea of rights of access to public space is something that actually seems really hard for people to grab onto in practice and to think of public space as legitimately public rather than just as a kind of extension of their own private holding. And right. And that's, you know, I see this constantly in these discussions. It's very hard to really get people to accept the idea. And the insight that you had, Eduardo, in your conversations with the homeless activists on Pershing Square, I think it was, you know, that moment of insight, of mutual respect, that was a really cool thing, and I'm something I'm going to think about. You know, how might that be an experience that could be scaled up, so that you could actually transform a community and not just reach individuals that way. And I really think that there are ways in which some of the built environment stuff can be turned into a means by which some of this transformation of community relations could take place. But that's what I'm struggling to think about is, you know, how does that kind of epiphany that you describe become something that a whole community could have together?
So I think you can fine-tune a public space. So you can go up and down a street and you begin to see places where there may be a weakness, where it may be a place that would draw in something uncomfortable. You can fine-tune that a little bit, add something else, put a cart out there. Another place you might be able to put a bench because it's associated with something. So you're kind of bringing up the social life of that space. You're not trying to eliminate, you're trying to kind of modulate. And you can do that in a park, like when we did Bryant Park, we had nine groups of people dealing in drugs, not nine people, nine groups of people. And when we did our activity mapping, we were looking at different kinds of drugs. We were doing activity mapping around different types of drugs. But then you know where the drugs are doing. Well, you put ice cream there or coffee. You know, you can replace, because they're in the prominent place. So you can just add, you can transfer that job to a more legitimate job. It's another form of what?
Commerce,
right. But I was going to use another word. So you can actually modulate places. And we worked in the Port Authority bus terminal in New York. Kathy, she's out meditating. But, we replaced the people hanging out around the columns with vendors from 8th Avenue. And so once you get hold of a place, it starts to kind of, you can bring down the more action-oriented aggression of trying to build it up. It gets to a certain level and it starts to perform on itself, and there's this kind of organicness to it. So the street is really a life, has a life to it. A public space has a life to it. So I know Sarasota a little bit, but we have a place in Delray, and we don't have those problems because the streets are so full of life, and you're always ready to bring more life to it. It sort of has this, if there's a vacuum, it fills in, and it draws more diverse people, and everyone is accessible for everyone, and everyone comes, and it's better for everyone. I don't know if that makes sense, but
yeah. So we have about 15 minutes before we wrap up, a little less than that, and I wanted to give members of the audience an opportunity to ask your questions, make your comments. Let's have a little bit of back and forth. And if you could say your name before you speak, it'd be nice. I'm going to call on these two guys if other people don't.
Up front, in the middle.
One brave soul.
Hello.
Yeah, I'm from India. My name is Amir. Yeah, what we I've been observing that what we're talking about, I haven't heard about what the public spaces are creating in the cities. Like, nobody is talking about gentrification to these public spaces and how do we control it, because it's a big deal. Like, most of the successful public spaces, the area around it is very expensive. It's not for the common people, and it's happening all around the world, and I'm serious about it. Like, how do we control it? Like, come on. It's like we talk about all the good things, and we are missing out the point of social equity, that public spaces should be accessible for all, not just the tourists, and also for the common people around the city. That's,
we talked about it in our breakout, didn't we? Yeah. Brett?
Yeah. So I'm not sure if you can prevent gentrification with public space only. I mean, it's about providing affordable housing, workspace housing, in areas that don't have it, of course, so that then we are talking about different mechanisms. But still, we've been working on a museum plan together in Amsterdam, and that was a tourist bubble, basically. And then you get into a process where the public space is only used by one group, and other groups start to avoid that place. And that's something you can do about. So the placemaking process there was to make this more into a space for average Amsterdamers to use as well, and get a much more mixed group. So here it was not the drug users, I guess, that were the problem, but the, maybe the tourists, they were not a problem, but it's a problem if there's only one type of use in a place.
Patrick Condon, you guys have quite a gentrification issue here, do you not, here in Vancouver? Do you want to comment on that?
I think Vancouver goes beyond gentrification. You know, it's not a local problem, it's a global problem. So everybody in the city is being gentrified out of it. The only people who are surviving it are the ones who have intergenerational transfers of funds. Like the baby boomers here are giving their kids $200,000, $400,000 from their equity, and that's how we're surviving. So some of those issues that I addressed in my talk are being played out here in a particularly vicious and dramatic way that goes beyond American ideas around gentrification. You have no idea. But since I have the microphone, I wanted to say something nice about the city, since you're mostly, I think, American in the room. When Peter was talking about, are we mostly American? I'm citizen. Hold up your hands if you're from the USA. Okay, about half. I wanted to say that in response to your absence of Main Street thinking, I should have celebrated this in my talk. The best, I grew up in Massachusetts, where all of our streetcar city fabric was destroyed, like every other metro area in the United States. And I was surprised to come here and see that the streetcar city fabric had never been destroyed. It had never been chewed up by parking lots and drive-through McDonald's and all the stuff that's destroyed streetcar main streets in American metropolitan areas. So, before you go home, you have to walk down Denman, Davy, and Robson in the downtown, which are basically right across the street from here in a big U. That'll take you about an hour. And even better than that, if you have 2 or 3 hours, you should go outside this immediate downtown peninsula and go stroll down Commercial Drive. We call it the Drive. And it's the Bohemian area, and it's not near the downtown, so Commercial Drive. And then another variation on a perfectly functioning streetcar city street is Broadway west of Burrard, and 4th Avenue west of Burrard until you get to Alma. So those of you who are interested in the thing that you were talking about, modest streets, not downtowns, but still very much functioning as beautiful linear space.
There's a lot more to Vancouver than the downtown that everyone thinks of as Vancouver, as you said. Other comments?
Yeah.
There's one right there.
Is it my
question? Oh, sorry. Go ahead.
Yes. Is it me? I don't know. Maybe you first?
Go ahead.
Okay. My name is Lisbeth Iversen from Norway. And I think there is one thing going on around in the world where a lot of cities are prohibiting begging and beggars. That made me leave politics after 10 years in the government of Bergen, because I could not accept that the government wanted to implement a law against begging in a city. actually legally saying that some people who were out of whatever in life could not ask somebody for help. And I was showing to the king we had in Norway in, you know, 1200. He had a law that was written for inhabitants, and it was a very good law, with taken into account social, economic, and environmental aspects by the public place. But he also said that it should be the right of the citizen to have access. So there's a law actually from 1276 saying that the public place, which is named in Norway Allmenning, All Men's Place, that's the public place name. And so what I'm concerned about it is the sustainability definition of United Nations and the public places and all the words about environment, socially, inclusion, and never talking about what about the legal right and trying to have a legal right to access the city and the public center and then try to work in accordingly to achieve that right for every person to be in this place. Because today that's not a fact. A lot of cities in Europe have laws against begging, and that means laws against poor people, actually. And they cannot sleep in the public place, they cannot, you know, access. So I think we need to really discuss not only design, which we have heard a lot of very good examples, but really how do we get people back on track and how do we give this public place to everybody? Thank you.
I don't think we need to answer. That was a beautiful comment. Yeah.
Mike Hill, I'm with City of Victoria, and we often have difficulty dealing with the diversity of issues on the street, which we've been talking some time about now. And what's interesting is it's often the objectifying of individual groups of people, especially what we loosely call the street community, and we don't understand them as people. And the reason I say this is there's one block in town where there's a regular group of panhandlers who are located along the block. And the merchants along that block have kind of adopted them. They know who they are. They tolerate them. They occasionally sleep in their alcoves in the front of their businesses. But it's a relationship that's kind of unusual because in other parts of our downtown, they don't have that same relationship. But they know, as I say, they know who they are by name and what their roughly their background is. So they're building relationships and understanding the human side of it when, as I say, often we just say, well, those people, we don't really understand them. We don't communicate them. We don't talk with them. But they're a problem on our block.
Well, a good street should be able to do that, because everyone is there. Both the residents and the merchants are all part of it, and they kind of have this acceptance of all kinds of people, and then it makes it even that more much more interesting. And we have that in Brooklyn, where we live, is we have various people that we see quite often, and they're part of our culture, they're part of our community. If I haven't seen one person for a while, and I'm a little worried about her.
But I think, just to add to that, there are ways to think in way, how would that happen? So it's quite likely, without knowing the actual context you're talking about, that that's not a place full of chain stores. Because they will have these clear rules where they are not personal at all. If they're independent businesses, not every independent business owner is, you know, is an angel, but the point is they are very much familiar with who it is, very likely somebody in the neighborhood, but maybe not. But somebody who's a regular. And so there is a level of trust that is very much human to human trust. It's not a corporation entity logo trusting or mistrusting another human.
Setha, did you have a
did you want Setha just gave me this microphone, I'm not sure why. Okay. Okay. My name is David Burney. I direct the Urban Placemaking and Management Master's program at Pratt Institutes in Brooklyn. But if I was to have a question, I guess it would be really about governance. We've talked a lot about the street and the ubiquity of the street and the importance of the street and how, I think, Vika, you talked about it being pan-cultural and so on. The problem we have in New York is with our controlling our streets and improving our streets is in part at least one of governance. And if you look at a typical New York Street, there are about 8 or 9 city agencies that have jurisdiction, Department of Transportation, environmental protection, the police department, the fire department, the parks department looked after the trees, the Department of Buildings regulates the signage, the Department of City Planning controls the facades, and so on and so forth. And there is no single entity that actually coordinates any of those functions. So if you just try to plant a tree on the sidewalk in New York City, you know, 50 people will come out and tell you you can't do it. And we haven't been able to overcome that. And I was pleasantly surprised that last year, the city of Stoke-on-Trent in England, which is a little post-legacy industrial city in the middle of England, created a new position, the Director of Place. And his job is to manage that coordination between those agencies. So I thought, wow, this is absolutely brilliant. And I'm hoping that as a movement, we can encourage other cities to adopt that very title, a Director of Place, because often as not, these improvements that we're all talking about, our biggest obstacle, you know, we have a saying in New York, when I was in government in New York, we've seen the enemy and it's us, you know? So I hope that we can move in that direction and overcome that problem of governance.
That's good.
That's terrific. Really good. And on that note, I think we're going to have to wrap up. But that and other great innovations and great approaches to solve these problems, we will take forward and take forward all the wonderful ideas that have come out of this conference and on to Quito and beyond. Thank you all very much.